I'm Brian Westbrook here at AWS reInvent 2025, joined now by the incoming CEO and president of LMI. This is Josh Wilson. And Josh, first of all, thank you for being here and congratulations. You are about to become CEO of LMI. As 2026 rolls in, tell us about not only the new role, but what challenges and opportunities you see LMI facing in the new year.
Yeah, you know, it's an exciting time for us. First, the public sector has been a dynamic place, if you think of last year. There's a lot of companies talking pivot, change, et cetera. And here we are, the first time in our 65 years, promoting somebody from within. And I think that's a testament to kind of the conviction we have about where we are and where we're going. We feel like we're postured really well. We've made some changes in the past previous years that have set us up well for this new administration and this kind of new guidance on where we're heading. And candidly, we like it. It's never been easier to do business with the government. You could have the exact right answer 10 years ago, 5 years ago for the government, but it was just too hard to do business with them. And the companies that are willing to invest ahead of need are postured well and are doing well. So LMI feels well positioned and we're excited.
And one of the ways that you become well positioned and that you're able to adapt and, if you will, be agile in this space is by applying commercial methodology to some of the federal missions, some of the federal work that you do. Tell us about how that secret sauce kind of works and why that's proven to be an advantage.
Look, the government couldn't be more clear. They're done paying for people to respond to their requirements. They want people to deliver against real outcomes. And that requires you to spend a lot of your own money ahead of need and have conviction around where you want to make a difference. I always kind of laugh when people say they're in the solution business. You go look at their income statement and they spend a ton of money on BD and all this infrastructure to respond to government procurements, and they spend pennies on R&D. You know, the last several years, LMI has spent way more on R&D in our CTO organization than we do our BD organization. And the impact on our P&L, the impact on the time at which we can impact customers' mission sets has never been smaller and shorter. And we've ruthlessly attacked those friction points that impede our ability to, you know, transform user experiences. And so today, you know, as you think about our bookings, like most of our bookings comes in the forms of non-competitive awards. And you don't get that unless you truly are showing up with something that's ready now, not ready 6 months from now or a year from now.
So the idea in the federal space is a bit of a pivot, if you will, a shift to build the product and then we'll buy it because you have the product ready for us, much like an enterprise organization in the private sector would do. Draw the comparison between those
two.
Yeah, I
want to, and I also want to caution us. Like, look, public sector is different. We're delivering against central services, you know, to our nation. We're supporting special operation units. You know, commercial speed is exactly what we need, but, you know, federal diligence and an appreciation of security is still a reality. And to be able to do commercial speed, you know, like they expect in that kind of model, but still acknowledge those realities of doing business in these highly unique mission sets, it requires an immense amount of investment every year, ambitious amounts. And that's been us, hundreds of millions of dollars year over year, ATO'd environments, classified facilities, comms, and then of course the R&D in the areas that we think we're well postured to really transform how the government does business, where we're spending an immense amount of our money not only attacking those friction points, but building solutions that are ready day one.
And I want to talk to you just a moment. We've both sort of lived our lives adjacent to the military. You've served yourself. How has that experience helped the 2,400 people of LMI adapt to understanding the problem set, understanding the unique requirements, and understanding what it takes to work with some of these complex projects?
Yeah, look, the LMIers, probably 25% of our population are veterans. You know, my wife is an active duty doctor. I have family members that support the special operations community and et cetera, multiple services. I think functional expertise is still relevant, right? It's never been easier and less complex to deliver world-class software. But if you're going to deliver solutions that sit at the nexus of software and hardware, you have to actually understand these unique mission sets that candidly are very different than a lot of the problems in the commercial sector. I have a full appreciation for there's an immense amount from commercial that could benefit public sector. But, you know, when you're deploying in, you know, hostile environments with, you know, the enemy has a vote and these contested environments, there are nuances that need to be appreciated. And functional expertise and background in that area make a difference.
And zero margin of error. Now, I want to talk to you about the acquisition that just happened here recently involving the Army and the Navy and a company that you've made an investment in. Tell us about that and what that's going to do for your portfolio.
Yeah, look, this is another example where LMI is doubling down ahead of need. Spectre is a solution that's being deployed across the Navy shipyards today. It's in the Army depots. It's having a transformative impact on their ability to do asset visibility, whether it be in transit or at rest. And it's a solvable problem but with a lot of unique security concerns. I think when you look at the pager incident in Israel, it matters right. where your batteries come from, right? So every part of this system has been checked, the supply chain is resilient, the software is approved, but by bringing all this IP under our umbrella, right, allows us to control scalability. It allows us to not have limitations that may be vendor related. And so we're really excited about this. It puts us as a forefront on federal sensor technology, especially as it relates to asset visibility. And it's a big investment on our part, but we think, you know, if the next conflict, you look out across, you know, where the next conflict goes, no question logistics is going to be a deciding factor of that conflict. And this puts us in a center of gravity opportunity there.
And sort of running full circle back to having that product and those services that the federal government will need at some point to the scale and resiliency and safety and security that you're able to deliver.
No one asked us to do this. Our government partners need us to be able to deliver against outcomes. And in this situation, by bringing all the IP under LMI, it allows us to really own scalability, really own custom configurations, and really own the pace at which we can deliver this solution, right? Whereas before we may have been relying on outside partners and et cetera, and we're not part of the solution now, we can deliver against the entire outcome. Like we can solve the asset visibility problem for our nation, and we're super excited about that.
Well, and it's certainly a great problem to solve, and we're glad that you're at the forefront of that, helping out and certainly helping all of our troops out there. Thank you so much. Chatting with Josh Wilson, the incoming CEO of LMI. I'm Brian Westbrook with GeekWire Studios. Thanks for watching.